Once sacred to the Cheyenne Indians, the mountain now holds some of the most closely guarded secrets of America's military elite. Half a mile inside the living rock is the headquarters of the North American Aerospace Defense Command, or NORAD. Built in the 60s, it was designed to survive at least the start of all-out nuclear war. Reagan was impressed, but concerned that NORAD could not, and still cannot, prevent nuclear missiles from landing. The high-tech control rooms are linked to powerful radar stations in several countries and to spy satellites in space. Here, officers can monitor any plane approaching US airspace or any ballistic missile launch anywhere on the planet.
Yes, sir, it does it this time.
The mission is to watch for the first sign of enemy attack. But today, tension is so low that this room spends much of its time looking for planes running drugs across the Mexican border. With the Cold War finally over, you might have imagined that this vast, hollowed-out mountain complex would gently become just a monument to the age of nuclear terror. But instead, the mountain is about to get a new lease of life. The US Congress has recently passed the Missile Defense Act, which instructs the government to spend billions of dollars on the first stage of what may become a Star Wars defense system. And the men who work here deep inside Cheyenne Mountain will play a vital part in it. It's Russia's nuclear missile bases that America's star warriors still point to justify their calls for fresh spending.
Расчет за мной, шагом марш.
Under current arms talks, the Russian rocket forces will take years to wind down. And there's the threat that their experts and technology will find their way to other, more dangerous countries. In Washington, General Daniel Graham has spent a decade campaigning for a Star Wars defense. He supports the new policy of planning a shield against limited missile strikes, which could one day come from a third world dictator or even the Russians.
Take, for instance, you have civil war in the Soviet Union or in what used to be the Soviet Union, and some marshal decides, well, the way to knit the whole thing back together is get us into another great fatherland war like we had before, and we all got together, so let's pop one at London or let's pop one at the United States. And then everybody will have to pull together. That's a scenario.
I think the Star Wars plans at this point are basically a solution in search of a problem. It's a system that isn't going to work to deal with a threat that basically doesn't exist. It's probably the least important thing that we could be spending money on right now.
We have wasted an awful lot of the money because we tried to deploy technologies that weren't ready too quickly. We were in a rush to spend the money because of the fact that the Reagan administration was going out of office in 1988, and the president wanted to show something for his efforts because this was his own personal program. Ronald Reagan was the program manager for the Strategic Defense Initiative.
President Reagan introduced the essential parts of his speech by the question, isn't it better to save lives than to avenge them? That was the best formulation I can imagine for the feelings and thoughts I had for many years. The fact is, the Cold War was never a war. The Cold War was a prevention of war. And the best prevention of war is to have adequate defenses so that an attack no longer can look hopeful.
Now 84, Teller is today at the center of bitter controversy over the Star Wars billions. At his urging, the government spent large sums on a weapon straight from science fiction.
As a weapon, it was supposed to achieve two things. It could handle simultaneously many attackers and from a distance, and it could penetrate without any question into the skin of the attacker, so as to throw off some material send into the attacking missile a shock which will destroy it. Actually, we need an X-ray laser, and I consider that a very real scientific accomplishment, quite independently of its possibilities as a weapon.
This is where America still does its underground nuclear tests, past a sign saying Environmental Research Park. Highly specialized equipment is used to monitor both standard nuclear weapons and exotic designs like the one Teller's team was trying to perfect. In the attempt to make the X-ray laser work, a series of 10 nuclear explosions was carried out in conditions of great secrecy. The X-ray laser tests were done more than 1,000 feet beneath these craters in artificial caverns hollowed out of the volcanic rock far below the desert floor. There, the nuclear bombs were linked to complex measuring instruments that in the billionth of a second before they were destroyed by the blast were supposed to measure the X-ray laser effects that Edward Teller had predicted. But as the series of top secret tests went on, it became increasingly clear that the results did not add up. At the Livermore National Laboratory in California, some of the scientists working under Edward Teller's guidance came to be openly scornful of this highly classified Star Wars project.
How close did the X-ray laser ever get to being able to shoot down a single missile, let alone 1,000?
Well, I can't be accurate about that for classification reasons, but nowhere near, I think, is adequate.
You're laughing.
Well, I mean,
the suggestion seems to you absurd that it would.
Nowhere near is sort of an exaggeration of its capability for that purpose, I think.
People were telling the program managers basically what they wanted to hear. The program managers were telling their bosses what they wanted to hear, and in many cases were exaggerating the progress that was being made.
What responsibility does Dr. Edward Teller hold for all this?
Well, I think Teller holds a great responsibility because he convinced the president of a couple of things. One, that this was feasible technologically. Two, that it was doable within a short time frame.
That one could perhaps shoot down the entire Russian missile force with a single X-ray laser the size of an executive desk. If that isn't misleading exaggeration, I've never heard of it. I've never heard of anything that was quite as exaggerated as that. That's frankly absurd.
Dr. Teller, did you mislead the administration as to what the X-ray laser could achieve?
The question is offensive. I certainly did not. I looked into the X-ray laser very carefully, told the government precisely what I knew, and furthermore, we achieved a little more than what I said we could.
The Strategic Defense Initiative is now racked by dramatic charges of waste and fraud. They have come from a Pentagon scientist who is a veteran of the successful Apollo program, which put men on the moon. The allegations, which will be investigated by the government, are made by the SDI's former chief scientist for advanced technologies, Aldrich Saucio. He claims that a senior Star Wars official simply invented important predictions for the number of missiles a Star Wars system could shoot down. He says space weapons that could never work were cynically promoted by contractors and research establishments.
I'm confident that at least $10 billion have been wasted in the SDI program since 1983 to the present.
It's suggested that a further $10 billion may have been wasted in something called the black program, the black budget. What does this mean?
Yeah, well, I am not limited to talk about black programs, of course. It's obvious it's something that's very sensitive to our national security, and that's being discussed with Department of Defense officials, the investigators, as well as Congress.
But you're suggesting that a further $10 billion dollars may well have been wasted in projects which you're not even able or at liberty to talk about.
That's right.
I don't know what wasted means. There has been a large expenditure on a number of programs that started in a different direction, and we changed direction for a number of reasons. In some cases, we decided they were technical dead ends. In other cases, the Congress cut our budget. We had to make hard choices between one doing one thing and another. I think some of that is normal for any big program of this sort. There were missiles to be launched, and the Brilliant Pebble authorized by the commander at Space Command in advance, it would maneuver into the path of an oncoming missile, and the impact would cause the destruction.
Work on a prototype is being done near Denver, Colorado. At the top secret SDI research block of contractor Martin Marietta, all they're showing for now is a life-size model. But the Pebble could be worth hundreds of millions if the company gets a contract to build it.
What happened was, initially, a lot of the contractors thought this was a bizarre scheme, but they're in the business to make money, and if that's where the money was, that's where they were going to go. Look at this year's defense budget. Everything's going down except SDI. So if you're in business to make money, you're going to move toward SDI, and then the contractors get together with the people in the office, and they make all kinds of claims.
The Brilliant Pebble is based on dramatic advances in miniaturizing rocket engines and guidance systems. But at a cost of several million dollars each, one important question is how long they could actually function in space.
Each system that we put together is designed for a given lifespan on orbit. The Brilliant Pebble requirement, as specified to us by our customer, the government, requires a life on orbit of several years.
How many years?
Obviously, I can't tell you the exact number because that would be a classified number, but it has a designed life of several years.
But it sounds as if, actually, its expected lifetime is not very great. We're talking about 4 or 5 years in orbit.
That's a fairly close number.
And at that point, it would have to be replaced with another one fired up from Earth.
That's correct. If you wanted to replenish the constellation, over an extended period of time, in terms of tens and twenties and thirties of years, you have to have, and the requirement does address that in terms of replenishment.
So you have to get some more Brilliant Pebbles from Martin Marietta and fire them into orbit.
Yeah, I hope so.
It cost $2 billion to build the National Testbed. Here, Star Wars designers play the world's most sophisticated computer games.
Break, this is missile warning. We have indication of a missile alert. Stand by for confirmation.
Get on the horn with him.
Wargamers plot the accidental launch of a Russian missile and shoot it down with ground-based interceptors.
Break, this is missile warning. We have a launch of SLBM N1 out of Murmansk, headed toward North America. This is a valid launch at this time.
What is our time to impact, and where is the impact area?
Intel update, this was the scheduled launch that the Soviets had planned. It has gone errant, and they are saying that they cannot knock it down at this time.
With 20 minutes before it lands in California, the missile is tracked by a planned satellite surveillance system called Brilliant Eyes.
Copy that. All RVs double engaged.
That's correct. Stand by, Saints. Go ahead, Army.
Then the interceptors are fired, and the missile vanishes from the screen.
Can you pass the word on that? Yes, we did use our assets and shut this down.
The computer system is being developed as the future heart of the North American Aerospace Defense Command.
It is needed more than ever. We used to be faced with the small probability of the incredible catastrophe that could well have ended Western civilization. We are now faced with a very real, considerable probability of use by small nations. Actually, Saddam Hussein used ballistic missiles. There are now 90 nations that have ballistic missiles, and the number and range are increasing. And we now have the means to stop that.
For now, the National Testbed's enormously powerful computer is perhaps the closest that Star Wars has got to reality. The Cray can perform 1 billion calculations a second. Its circuits, cooled by a fluid, that imitates human plasma. But after spending $25 billion on research, with another $4 billion this year, the Star Wars program is now at the crunch point. With the Cold War over and the government deep in the red, will the US really spend more billions on building interceptors to guard against a missile threat that many simply don't believe in?
Well, I guess the fundamental question that I have to ask myself is that when I walk the streets of Washington, D.C., or when I walk the streets of Washington, D.C. at night, what am I mainly worried about? I'm not mainly worried about being attacked by missiles. I am worried about being robbed as I walk home. I think that today we are spending far too much money dealing with very improbable military threats and not spending nearly enough money dealing with the decay of our own society and the immediate threats that we face as we walk our streets.
This is a missile warning. I have a missile alert. Stand by for confirmation.
Our time to impact is just over 24 minutes.
And they will not divulge whether these are armed or not.
Director Cobbs. Yes, sir.
I assume they are.